Welcome to this episode of Unraveling Adoption, an intentional space to delve into adoption's complexities together. I'm Beth Syverson. I'm an adoptive mom of a diligent and creative 20-year-old son, Joe, who is trying to launch into adulthood. I'm walking beside him while working on my own personal growth and healing. I'm still trying to launch as well. We are committed to helping anyone touched by adoption, and we want to help the general public understand adoption's complexities better too. For today's episode, we kind of have a double header. We have two guests, Sarah Reinhardt and Louise Browne, a pair of adoptees who have a podcast together called Adoption, The Making of Me. Perhaps you've heard it. We're going to learn about their adoption stories, their friendship, and some inside scoop about their podcast. So welcome to Unraveling Adoption, Sarah and Louise. Glad to have you here.
Glad to be here.
Thank you.
Yeah.
I like the double header part. You did like a little baseball.
You like that? Yeah. I am not a sports person, but I do know about double headers. So I've listened to a lot of you guys' episodes of Adoption Making of Me. I really enjoy your vibe. I love your format. You always bring in a book that you're reading. I think both of you are same race, domestic, baby scoop era adoptees, right?
This is true.
But you have much different adoption stories.
Yeah.
How are your paths different?
Well, there's so much to speak on, isn't there, Sarah? I'm Louise.
I'm Sarah.
Well, Sarah and I used to own the food truck together, a gourmet ice cream truck, and we were the scream team back then. We weren't the podcast team.
Why were you called the scream
team? We were the scream truck.
Oh, that was the name of your mm-hmm. Oh, the scream truck, like ice cream. Yeah. Oh, I get it. Oh, that's cute.
And we, you know, we do have some similarities right away, just being adopted. Mm-hmm. I have hazel eyes. Sarah has green, but green eyes. Mm-hmm. And just, I don't know, we're both born in September right next to each other. We have a lot of funny humor together, which makes us work, but we are different people. Sarah, do you want to speak on anything?
Well, I was adopted, like my birth mother did not want to give me up. I found out later she was forced. She was one of those single mothers, teenage mothers who, and she too was adopted. So,
oh, really?
I just got all of my unredacted records this past month and I'm still processing and still kind of reading it, but when I read her intake at the hospital, it talked about when her mom left the room, her adoptive mom, then she felt freer to talk. And she told the social worker, nobody had ever talked to her about her adoption. And she had a lot of shame and guilt and struggled, did not want to give me up. And she, her water had broke on a flight on the ascent from JFK to St. Louis. So it was just completely, had it been 20 minutes earlier, I would have been born in New York, maybe kept. Maybe put up for adoption, but in an entirely different circumstance. Wow. So it's kind of, anyway,
that's
so,
quite a story.
And I also am unsure if she actually knew she was pregnant because she only gained 7 pounds. She never had a prenatal visit.
Wow.
She didn't tell anybody. Nobody knew. So that makes me think maybe she didn't, even though I was in reunion with her. And she said she did. It's just my instinct. So,
oh, wow.
And then I was adopted into a family like that lived a couple hours. Well, first, I went to foster care and the whole nine yards. And then I was 5 or 6 weeks old and adopted into a family in a smaller town about 2 hours away and young couple, like 23. And then a few years after I was born, they adopted my brother. And then when he was 5 months old, they got pregnant with twins.
Hey, oh, no.
I mean, in those early years, I have happy memories of.
Okay.
But then when I was 7, they got divorced.
Oh.
And instead of him leaving, she left. And it wasn't by choice. And I don't want to tell her story. But so there we were. Just I was 7. My other adopted brother was 4 and the twins were 3. And it was just, and my dad just shut down.
Like, whoa.
That's where our stories differ. Then from that point on, my happy childhood, not knowing anything except I was chosen. And I say that in quotes for people listening.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah. So that's kind of where my happy childhood ended.
Yeah. That sounds really rough. Did you become a parentified child? Did you have to take care of your siblings at 7?
I did do a lot of that. And let me be clear. My mom wasn't out of the picture. She moved about 30 minutes away and then she went back to school and then got her degree, then got remarried and then went to Miami. So we would spend every other weekend. I mean, but it wasn't ideal. So.
Wow, that sounds rough.
But yeah, I did kind of become that way. Yes.
Mm-hmm, I bet. being the oldest. Whew. What about you, Louise, the Reader's Digest version of your adoptive story?
I like that. We were talking about that today. How do we make our stories Reader's Digest versions?
I know.
I'm from Colorado, and my biological mother gave me up for adoption willingly, but I say that loosely, like mm-hmm. Sarah with quotes loosely, because now have a bunch of her mail, handwritten mail to her mm-hmm. sister mm-hmm. and to her mother, which I didn't have before. I used to have just one set of letters. And, you know, there was a lot of coercion along the way with a constant social work visit mm-hmm. every week
wow.
saying, you know, you should really give your baby up for adoption. It's the Jeez. Best thing. You're 19, even though you're working, this isn't stable. And she really kind of just started to buy into that. Mm-hmm. Although when she had me in the hospital, she kept me for 3 days. Mm-hmm. So I was with her for 3 days, and that she wasn't willingly doing it at that time. Mm. But I don't think anybody really came to see her or could financially yeah. from where she was. And eventually she signed me over, and I think it affected her greatly. And she died, you know, tragically in 1975. So about 7 years later.
Wow. Oh, gosh, mm-hmm. I'm so sorry.
Yeah. Oof. And I think, you know, she had a good life, but I think it really affected her deeply mm-hmm. because you don't know, you know. So I was adopted right away into a home, two parents, and I was the second child. My brother is 5 years older. He was kept. He was their child.
Okay.
My mom couldn't have a second baby. She had delivered a stillborn baby.
Mm. Oh, gosh.
Having Rh negative blood back before you could take the pill for that.
Okay.
And so she couldn't have more kids. And I don't think anybody dealt with what she went through with that. Mm. She carried a full-term baby, and it died in her womb, and she had to keep carrying it and deliver, and yeah.
Oh, that's so
hard. I think there was a lot of trauma there for my mom. Yeah.
Definitely.
I had a really loving home. There are some things that are weird, you know, along the way. As I'm out of the fog, you're like, wait a second, that was really messed up, you know, some little things. But for the most part, I'd say, you know, on the Richter scale, I scored a really high family. And I always just have that sort of thing. Like, what if they weren't the ones that picked me up? Right. Mm-hmm. Like Sarah said, she could land in New York and have a whole different yeah. life. Like, it's very bizarre.
It is.
I was curious about being adopted. I was always, you know, knew I was adopted, had the normal kind of you go through your life feelings. Mm-hmm. I did want to know a lot of things and was shut down. Mm. It wasn't really an open topic. It was open in the interesting way, but not in the investigative way.
And, okay. So you could yeah. be curious, but there was going to be no answers and no
right.
digging. Okay.
Right. Oof. It's not like what you and your son go through and the discussions. It was all like, oh, that will hurt your mom's feelings, or we're your family. And even now there's some of that, to be honest with
sure.
you,
sure.
with my sibling and with, I shouldn't say with other family members. They just don't ask. So I actually don't know how they feel.
Same on my end.
Yeah.
No one.
It's mm-hmm. pretty common for people your age, right? Mm-hmm. That baby Skibira, that a lot of secrecy and shame and just la, 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 la. We're just not going to talk about it.
When Louise was talking about the other family picked you up, had I been born in New York, something Moses mm-hmm. Farrow had said on our podcast that had never even occurred to me was adoptees live alternate realities.
Mm. Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah. I just read a quote about that. Like when I was born, I kind of split into two, and I asked my son, I said, do you feel like that? And he goes, yeah, that's really... Mm-hmm. intense, but yeah, I do. And God, that just must be so hard to deal with. You don't know any different, but that just must be a huge burden to add to everything.
You don't know any different, but you know something's not right.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Your whole life, like, I mean, I was pretty fogged for a long time. So like, even if you're happy and you're fogged, you still know something's not right. Like I would just keep it internal and be like, something's messed up with me.
Mm-hmm.
And why am I always not fitting?
Mm-hmm.
Right.
Yeah. And you directed it toward yourself because how do you know?
Even you know, yourself or outwardly or you.
Yeah.
You know.
Oh, gosh. Now, one thing I love about your podcast is that you both are pretty new, freshly out of the fog. I mean, you're not like some, you know, experts in the
area. We came out of the fog in real time on our podcast.
It's like an experiment.
Yeah, yes. We're watching it as you go through. You're like, put yourself into this. You chose to do it, so I don't feel bad for you.
No.
You did it yourself. But it's very informative and helpful for us listening. And like, oh, wow. And me as an adopted parent, I'm always very curious to watch this unfolding. And I'm sure other adoptees listen and go, whoa, I never thought of that either. Huh. I'm sure it helps people to dig into into more depth and to explore these topics. How did you come out of the fog? And you both knew each other well before you came out of the fog. So how did all that happen?
Sarah and I were talking that we weren't 100% fogged in the way that, you know, like I had gotten married in 2018 and had both families at my wedding. Like there was some definite pushback and crossover. Sarah had met her family, but we didn't know that our issues stemmed. Go ahead, Sarah. What were you going to say?
Yeah, I was just going to say, just because you go to in reunion or any of that stuff, it doesn't mean you're not in the fog.
Right. Yeah, true. Yeah.
For me, what I interpret coming out of the fog is to kind of wake, because especially in our era, we were just told, you know, you were chosen and you're, you know, whatever little cliches are out there about how wonderful adoption is. And I didn't question that. Mm-hmm. And I had convinced myself that I was better off, that, oh boy, good thing I wasn't raised in that family or whatever it is. Mm-hmm. And it wasn't until we started the podcast and we read The Primal Wound and then on to The Journey of the Adopted mm-hmm. Self, where I literally had a wake up moment of going, this is so weird. You take a baby yes. from somebody and put it into a family of complete strangers mm-hmm. who aren't necessarily that vetted. Yeah. I got vetted for my dog maybe more than I've been vetted, you know, one afternoon, come over for lunch and then, okay, we'll get you a baby soon. It's just bizarre.
I mean, bizarre.
That was what I thought about coming out of the fog. And then from that point, going to connecting all the dots.
There were certain quotes, like I remember reading The Primal Wound and certain quotes would hit me. Like there was a psychologist who was interviewed in The Primal Wound, I forget, or quoted when he said like adoptees are the only trauma victims who are expected to be grateful, that kind of thing. I remember being like, I'm a trauma, like, ooh. Whoa, like these big aha moments where I think about it for days, right? Mm. Journey of the Adopted Self, really. Sarah and I both went through a lot of emotional mm-hmm. ups and downs. Yeah. I mean, really heavy. And we're like podcasting about it. So you're like, okay, let's talk about it. And some days you don't want to. It was really intense, you know?
Yeah, especially like I remember in the beginning, we would do back to back like 3 or 4 interviews.
Oh, wow.
We didn't know what we were doing.
And then just... yeah, we know.
It's intense. So when you started your podcast, you had no idea this was going to happen to you.
No.
You're just like, well, we're both adopted. Let's do an adoption podcast.
You know what we thought? I think we thought we are adoptees. We bonded over that quickly too.
Okay.
As we have with other friends. I have friends, Sarah has friends who are adopted who are mm-hmm. maybe closer friends instantly than other people would be because of being adopted, uh-huh. right? That's something that's very hard to explain to a non-adopted person that you can literally... Mm-hmm. meet a guy in a bus line and be like, I'm adopted too, and instantly have stuff that you connect on.
Okay.
Like you're starting a platoon or something, you know? It's like that same camaraderie.
Right, yeah, right. Exactly. It's like this camaraderie. So
you've lived through the war.
You live through something that just both of you go, mm-hmm. I got that, right? Mm-hmm. And then I think we thought we're adoptees. We never really hear about anything. In our world, we're always in this vacuum. We talk to each other and a few friends, so... we'll just interview anybody that's in this adoption world mm-hmm. and explore it. No idea what was ahead. First of all, we didn't even know there was communities, like anything at all.
Wow. At all. And I had never, ever read one book about adoption.
Wow. Me neither.
Nothing until we chose The Primal Wound. We're like, okay, let's do this book thing.
Yeah.
I mean, had we not chosen to do that book, we probably still would be.
We'd still be saying ridiculous things.
In the fog.
Whose idea was it to use a book as a kind of a grounding?
Sarah.
Ah, it's fascinating.
Sarah, because we were talking about interviews and she's like, we need something at the opening. And she had heard about it recently again. I had that book on my shelf. I can't remember who gave it to me, but I never cracked it. I'll tell you. And then it went away in a move.
Yeah.
So I was like, oh, well, not that book. I have to buy that book and read it. You know, like the cover always bothered me. Like the name of it, The Primal Wound. I was like, so she thought of it and I thought, okay, why not? That's literally what it was pretty funny.
Wow.
I mean, I think if we hadn't done that and we just were in our little mm-hmm. bubble interviewing anybody who mm-hmm. came along, like, I don't think we would have come this far and B, wouldn't have come out of the fog. It really took the books to get us there.
And our cool listeners and friends, like, I have to say, now that we're kind of, I mean, this is our third year and we're going into season 6 soon.
Nice.
We have such a community. You're part of our community, right? So it's mm-hmm. like people were really gracious to us, actually, when I look back, because they must have been like, who are these people?
We on our first season, we were just talking about it today. We like had a woman who ran an orphanage in South Africa. I mean, it was just like the people we were having on. It's just funny.
But you know, I still feel good about, I don't really like to go back and listen to the beginning, but sometimes I feel good because I was thinking about that when Sarah and I talked about this woman who, Nikki, who ran an orphanage for children in South Africa. She was playing our podcast to everybody to learn more about how the kids felt. Okay. Right. So
that's right. Yes.
That's why she wrote us, because she said, I've been listening to this. I'm making everyone listen so they understand maybe how these babies are going to feel. So you kind of think, okay, it was weird, but at the same time, whoever listens to any content to grow, including us.
You're right. Good point, Louise. I went for the
Well, no, we had a couple other cheap jokes. We were laughing. We're like, oh my goodness.
It's hard to think about because when you're in it, you think you know what you're doing. And then you realize, oh, you don't know what you don't know. But I always enjoy you guys. And you kind of have a dark sense of humor sometimes. And you just make it seem so real and approachable.
Sarah has dark humor and I laugh.
Okay. Well, that's how we can tell you apart.
I also have dark humor. I just like to like laugh about it. Like I live for dark humor, and Sarah has one-liners, and I live for when she's going to say one. I'm like, say it.
Oh my gosh.
I could see your face earlier starting to laugh when you anticipated something.
So funny. I just finished listening to your whole series about the Georgia Tan book, The Baby Thief, right?
Oh gosh.
You were like so happy to be done with that book.
Yes.
And no shade to the author of that book, Barbara Raymond, right?
Mm-hmm.
Barbara Bassanza Raymond. Yeah, we said that. You know.
Yeah, you did say that.
Very well-written book. Glad to be leaving.
Well-written. And Georgia Tan was evil.
She's just horrific.
Yeah.
You know, it's hard to read that.
For those that don't know, do you want to give a very brief synopsis of what Georgia Tan did?
I mean, she was kind of the OG baby trafficker in America that was responsible for all the privacy laws, for the fake birth certificates and kidnapping children. I mean, so boldly that she would go into people's yards and take toddlers from the yards. And,
horrible.
And she was so cunning and a brilliant mind, really, that she was able to get all of the politicians, you know, and it just, it spread. It was like a virus spreading throughout the country.
This is why we had the baby scoop era of privacy.
That's how it started.
It's interesting to learn the history because it's one thing to kind of go, okay, here we are. This is what's happening. But it's another thing to go, wow, this didn't always exist.
Yeah. The thing about her story that makes me really think deeply is she was one person that made that big of an impact.
Right.
So conversely, one person could make a huge positive impact.
Yes.
But we have to be careful because one person can really make things really, really bad.
And the just the widespread ripples of
still,
to think, you know, how the tentacles of even so indirect that, you know, an adoptee doesn't know how to love and has to give up a child. And it just, the cycle, you know, that the ripple effects are so astounding.
We're going back to memoirs, by the way. You know, even though they're hard too, there's some, you know, it's a little different. That was a hard book. That book was just brutal.
Yeah. Well, I know you said a couple times on there, other people have said, thank you for reading it. So I don't have to. So I haven't read that whole book yet, but yeah, I learned a lot from listening to you guys. So thank you for doing that hard emotional labor. I'm sure that was really tough. What has been the hardest thing as a podcaster in this adoption world? What struggles or challenges have you run across that you've had to figure out?
As a podcaster or as a podcaster in the adoption world?
The second one.
I think they may be different struggles for each of us. And as a podcast, like for me, it's like, what line do you walk and not be careful? But I think, and Sarah may feel different or she may feel the same. Like I would like all adoptees to be able to say their story, no matter who they are, fogged, unfogged, loved their life growing up, were abused and horrible life growing up, whatever. I'd like everybody to say their story and have the space to do that because I think so many adoptees don't ever tell anybody anything. And then it's kind of the line to walk about, you know, you just kind of just to be open and learn. Like we're not experts. Nobody is an expert, maybe. Maybe there are experts, but I'm not an expert, right? So when someone asks me my opinion, I can say my opinion, but you may want to talk to somebody with this knowledge or that's kind of my challenge. What about you, Sarah?
Well, yeah, part of it is that my adoptive mom listens to my podcast.
Okay.
And that can be really, sometimes I try not to have that in my head, but it's mm-hmm. still there. And then I feel like it compounds my guilt.
Mm-hmm. Has she talked to you about what she's heard on the podcast?
Well, in the beginning, yes. And she would talk about her hurt feelings or want to go back and relive our, like, tell me what happened, that what happened wasn't her fault or what.
Yeah. Defensive.
And I had to put some boundaries, which is difficult. Yeah, I bet. Very, very difficult in that relationship. So that definitely has been a challenge. And I'm with Louise. Like, I do think, and we've always kind of committed to just, once we went down the road of adoptees, we just committed to all adoptees have the right. That's what we're here for. If they want to tell their story, mm-hmm. they can come tell their story. So it doesn't matter what that is. It's, you know, because it might, every story helps somebody somehow. Mm-hmm.
There's somebody in the same place as they are.
Yeah.
And sometimes if you had a really great childhood and somebody else didn't, you can have more empathy for people that had a different experience from you either way, either similar to you or different from you.
Well, and Louise and I kind of represent each side of that coin.
Yeah, you do. And what, besides coming out of the fog, which you didn't expect, what other surprises have you had making the podcast together? What's come up that you're like, whoa, I never expected that?
I think we ran a business together, which was not this. Okay. It was like hardcore on the streets, like, you know, a total business school without going to business school. Like,
yeah.
The kind of job that you have tan arms at the end of the day.
Right? Tan arms.
And muscles.
But also we were raising, muscles. And we're in the middle of raising teens, boys, in the middle of this. I was going through a divorce. Sarah was going through her own stuff. Like, it was hard sometimes. Right. And we survived it. We had our ups and downs and took a break from each other after we had our business end. But I find that we run this really well together. Mm-hmm. We don't have that many bumps in the road for how much work we have to do.
That's great.
I was thinking about today, like, we do a lot of work. It's a weekly podcast, right?
Mm-hmm.
And people may not know what goes into that, but we both work full time. Mm-hmm. And you'd think we'd be like, you know, we've only had a couple of discussions where we're like mad at each other. And besides that, we're like, okay. And that, I think because we've done this together, we have empathy.
Yeah.
Like, I see Sarah so much deeper than I used to. And I think maybe she sees me and I'm just like, yeah.
You worked it all.
Like, I don't need to win that war. I don't need to be the way I'm being. I'm being horrible. You know, you think about it differently.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. And there's a level of trust. Mm-hmm. I mean, look, it took a long time to really get, I mean, we trusted each other. We were business partners and trusted each other in that way. And, but I mean, on a deeper level of this person really knows me and sees me. And is still here.
And still here. They still love me. Yeah. Like, for instance, you know, like Sarah and I can say something to each other about each other, but you, someone else from the outside, word, I'd be like, you don't get to talk. You know, I'd be like her biggest defender.
That's right. Well, your strength in your friendship is very evident when we listen. And you can tell you've known each other for a long time. And it sounds like you've worked out a lot of stuff in your previous business. So that was handy.
Yeah.
But this one is so much more personal because the other one was an ice cream truck, right? So product that's melting and like money and stuff like that. This is very personal and very intimate, much different. Yeah. But I bet you worked out a lot of those kind of negotiating and that kind of stuff. Because it's hard with two people. You don't have a person to break a tie or you just have to figure it out.
Yeah, we kind of just, we're both good at certain things and we just kind of go with it. And we both are good at crossover things that we can both do.
Mm-hmm.
But we kind of are like, okay, you just handle that. I'll handle this. And then we step in and help each other. I don't know. It works out.
Nice.
And we pretty much are aligned with everything that we're doing, you know, the ideas for going forward. Mm-hmm. Just, I mean, we're just aligned. We're not different in that way. Like, we just agree.
That's great.
In that. Yeah. Does that make sense? Mm-hmm. Aligned is really the word.
Yeah, it's great. It's lucky when you find people like that. That's great.
It is.
Mm-hmm. What are your visions for the future with the pod? Or do you plan to expand beyond the pod? Or
gosh, this is the question.
I mean, it's kind of a day at a time. I mean, yes, we'd love to go bigger, reach wider audiences. There's more adoptees out there in all stages of their life that would be great to somehow reach. And how do you get the tools to get there? It's just a slow build, I guess.
You go through this too, right? So it's like, I'm sure as a podcaster, it's like, okay, how long do you do the podcast? And then, I don't know, does it turn into something else? But like, we're such on a roll. I mean, we have guests booked through July.
Wow.
Yeah. And we wouldn't want to not let them tell their story. You know what I'm saying? It's like, you just, I don't know. we were asked that recently, and we were both thinking, well, we have ideas, but then we also have real life you're handling every day. So
yeah, this isn't your full-time job for sure. But yeah. It's on the side, such important work. I know you're doing some big thing in New York coming up.
Yes. You know, Rebecca Autumn.
Yes. I've hosted her film screenings and big fan of Rebecca Autumn Sansom.
Same. So they're doing Operation Fog Lift number 2, and it's going to be in New York City on February 3rd. And we are hosting a happy hour sponsored by us and hosted by us along with our sponsor, S12F Jeff, who was on our podcast in season 4.
Okay.
And yeah, so he's kind of sponsoring the whole weekend, nice. Putting the movie up. So we've got that happy hour that we're hosting, TBD of where it will be.
We know it's from 6 to 8 in Hell's Kitchen. We just haven't nailed down.
Okay.
Yeah. And then the next night is the screening of Reckoning with the Primal Wound. And then Liz DeBetta has a one-woman show.
Mm-hmm. Unmothered. And she's also doing a writing workshop on Sunday the 4th for a small amount of people. You know, I think she can host 20 or something like that. So anybody that's an adoptee or a supporter of the show or anything like that can come to the happy hour, even if you can't come Saturday and you don't have tickets. So we'll be there and just we're figuring out where it is and we'll announce that.
Yeah, well, that sounds like an amazing opportunity. And is this your first in real life, in-person event, or have you done other ones like that?
No, this is it.
This first time you'll meet people and they'll actually be able to see your actually exist in real life. It's so cool.
We've met a few people from the show. Sarah's met in Kansas City and some I've met in California, but we haven't had anything like this.
I've only gone to a few things. Well, when Autumn had her film screening here, and I've been to a couple of conferences, and it's transformative, actually seeing people and like interacting with them in real life. It's really incredible. I encourage anyone to do it, in anyone in the constellation. It's really impactful. It's different. I mean, podcasts are great because we can take you in our car and while we're cooking dinner, and you know, it's different.
We're kind of nervous, you know, because we're going to see all these people we know, that we know, but we don't know.
What are you going to wear? Oh my gosh.
But know us.
I know. What am I going to wear? Jeans.
Yeah.
Jeans.
Yeah.
I'm always in jeans. Yeah, maybe not. Maybe we'll have on something else.
Well, that's exciting. I'll make sure this podcast gets out before the event so people can come out and join you in New York.
Okay,
that would be amazing.
Yeah.
Should come. I wish I could. I would love to support Autumn with that and Liz too. I know Liz from that Adoptee Remembrance Day thing, but
she's so neat.
I'm in Southern California. That's a huge schlep to go to New York, but I would love to go to New York someday. Maybe someday.
Yes.
What is your advice to adoptive parents? A lot of people listen to our show are adoptive parents or just community members that aren't even touched by adoption themselves. But what advice do you each have for adoptive parents?
I was just talking to an adoptive parent that's a friend of a friend recently, and I just think it's hard because I'm also a parent. So I think, okay, it's easy for me to say, but like if someone were telling me how to parent my child, that would be hard, right? For me to be egoless or whatever. Mm-hmm. But I think the number one thing is to really have an open communication and not just say it's an open communication. Like if your child says, I want to find, you know, my birth family, or I want to know about this, you're not like, of course, inside you can be wounded, but that shouldn't be your like facial expression, or you really have to do the work for that because it's kind of a natural birthright to know who you are.
Definitely. Yeah. So adoptive parents, go do your own work.
Yeah. And like, it's not personal.
Yeah,
so even definitely. if your kid gets angry and says, I want my real mom, you know, you just can't internalize that and take it personally. It's because then that puts guilt, you know, the last thing that you want to do to your child is guilt and shame them
definitely
with your unspoken language. So, which would really require you to do the necessary healing so that you are not reflecting that back to that child.
Yeah.
Yeah, definitely. And there are feelings for sure. Adoptive parents have feelings about reunion and search and things aren't the way we thought they would be. And we have feelings about that, which are fine. Go talk to your own therapist about it. Go talk to your adoptive parents' friends about it. Don't put that on your kids. I totally agree with you guys.
Oh, and a reminder that we're not blank slates. That's another reminder.
That's the big one. We're not blank slates. You come with some DNA and things you may like and who you are. And I was thinking that since Sarah and I came out of the fog, and I was older than 50, I'm not going to speak for Sarah too. she's only older than 40.
What?
my son's older now, and he's in his 20s. And I wish I knew what I knew when I raised him. So I'm not like, I don't want adopted parents to hear this and think, well, they think they're so perfect. Cause you know, we do get a little bit of emails and things like that. Truly, like, I didn't do all the work I should have done. And I wish I did, because I'm still undoing some of that myself as an adoptee, pushing down my adoptee weirdness.
Oh, okay.
Okay. Cause that's a thing too, is like your intergenerational trauma. Mm-hmm. I didn't even know I was doing these things. Now I'm like reading The Primal Wound and Journey of the Adopted Self. I'm like, oh my God, like this, some of this fits my son and he's not adopted. Mm-hmm. And it's because of me. And his dad helped with some of that too. But you know what I'm saying?
So yeah. So whatever's unfinished, we just keep passing along to our kids. And no matter how hard we try, there's always going to be stuff we're going to do wrong.
Always.
So,
I mean, that's why therapists exist for,
They'll always be in business. Therapists, thank goodness.
They'll always be in business for their parents' sins. But yes. Really, if you know you're going into adoption or to adopt, there's so many books, and talk to an adoptee and get in a group. And if you're adopting a child that's maybe not of your racial origin, get in groups of their racial origin, like whatever you need to do.
Yeah, dig in. Yeah, I totally agree with you. Dig in. There's so much available nowadays.
Yeah.
There's really no excuse to just go, oh, I didn't know. Just Google it. It's easy. Easy to find.
Yeah. Listen to your podcast.
Yes. That'd be a good place to start. Yes. Sarah, did you have any other things to add about adoptive parent advice?
Well, I think I kind of just not take things personally, okay. Do the work, heal yourself, and understand that if you're getting a baby, that they are their own person. You're not going to be able to just project, and you can project, but it's not a good idea to do so.
Yeah, you can. You can if you want to. Very harmful for everybody involved.
Very
harmful. Does not help anything. Well, those are some really good words of advice. Thank you, guys. Do you think it's possible to have too many adoptee podcasts or podcasts about adoption?
Oh, we used to ask this about dessert trucks.
Exactly. If you break it down mathematically, though, right? Adoptees are what? 2.5% of the population in America. Mm-hmm. We have, 350 million people in America. Uh-huh. So that means there's 4 million adoptees out there. There's not too many for that many people, I think.
Yeah.
And everybody's different. Like, we listen to other people's podcasts too, and I get something from theirs because everyone asks different questions. They have a different vibe. Mm-hmm. I mean, I just started listening to Simon Benz. I had never, we're going to be on his. And I was like, oh, it's totally different and interesting. And there's ones about how adoptees go to work and all sorts of interesting. Yeah,
that one's a good one too. Yeah, I think there's room for everyone. I always feel like there's enough. There's enough of everything. Mm-hmm. And everyone has a little segment that they do special, a little niche that they fit. And people will be drawn to different people. So it's important to have all these different voices. And I love being colleagues, I guess, of you guys. And just being in the same space together, I think it's wonderful. And we can all help each other out. And everybody can find exactly what they need with all these different options.
Yeah. We having that abundance mindset, right? Like the next one that comes along isn't going to push you away or compete. You know, we're not in competition with each other.
No, Sarah and I are big on reaching out and trying to get people on ours. Like, one of our first guests was Damon Davis, right?
Uh-huh. Yeah.
We're like, oh, we love him. Let's get him on, you know, because he was so generous to us because we were so clueless. But I feel that whenever we meet someone else, it's like we're all doing this good work. And really, most people don't listen to our voices in the bigger world, the Hollywood world. You know what I'm saying? The story narrative of adoption. So
yes,
maybe somebody happens upon somebody else's and not ours. And it's important for the bigger picture.
Right. Okay. This is my last official question.
Okay.
If you could interview any adopted celebrity, who would it be?
We both have one.
I really, really, really want Keegan-Michael Key.
Oh, nice. That'd be amazing.
Yeah. And I want Colin Kaepernick.
Oh, man. I loved his documentary. Very good.
Me too. And we both want Frances McDormand.
I didn't know she was an adoptee. Holy cow. Yes. I didn't know that.
She's an adoptee and an adoptive parent.
Wow. Ooh.
Yeah. Be interesting.
I want Simone Biles.
Ah, Simone Biles.
She's adopted?
She's fostered, kinship adopted. Yeah, kinship, I think.
I didn't know that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Well, maybe you can send this up to those people and get them on our podcast.
Keegan Michael, I'm talking to you.
We'll help you. You help us.
Yeah. That's right. Whoever knows these people, we want them.
There's actually a lot of people. Like we go through lists sometimes and think, oh, wouldn't it be neat to have them on? And we have asked a few people and they've said no, or they just don't answer. But
yeah, we asked Ice-T.
Oh, yeah?
Ice-T twice.
He got to his manager somehow twice, a year apart. And the response was just the same. Ice is going to pass on this right now.
Oh,
something like that.
Yeah, that's okay.
I think Skrillex is adopted and he's one of my son's favorite artists. And I sent an email. I'm like, hi, I heard nothing. He's like, crazy lady. No, thank you. But you never know.
You got to be bold. You got to, why not?
They'll never say yes if you don't ask. So you just ask.
Exactly. That's exactly. I mean, we've been really bold.
Yeah.
Starting, back when at the ice cream truck and now with the podcast, it's just believing that, why not?
Why
shouldn't someone be on? Why not?
Absolutely.
Why not?
I totally agree with you. Well, if people wanted to get a hold of you or listen to your pod, what's the best way for them to find you?
Anything with adoption, The Making of Me or At Mom Adoption. We're kind of like everywhere under that logo.
So your acronym is like @mom@mom.
Mm-hmm.
I love that. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, or just @mom. That's our that's our logo. Uh-huh.
Adoption, The Making of Me logo. And then our email is themakingofmepodcast@gmail.com.
Okay.
And make sure you put The Making of Me podcast because there is a making of me. And this poor woman got a lot of emails. She was like, oh my God, here's another guest for you.
Oh, what is her business?
I'm not sure. She was really nice. She would pass things on and it doesn't happen that much anymore. She probably got rid of it.
Oh, that's funny.
Yeah, I forgot about that.
And I think it's so cute when you have your acronym at mom because it's like, okay, that's very adoption appropriate.
Isn't that?
Yeah. We didn't mean that.
You didn't make the words make an acronym like that on purpose. Wow.
No.
Yeah, that's pretty cool. That's really cool. Well, it's been great getting to know you guys a little bit better. And I will continue listening to your pod. And I love what you're doing.
Thank you.
And I wish you all the best. Good luck on the New York trip and everything. And
I wish you could be there, but next time.
Maybe, you never know. I'll try. I'll try if I win the lottery.
Thank you for what you're doing too.
Yes.
Yeah.
I'm trying to elevate Adoptee Voices and do whatever I can to help people like my son and help adoptive parents know better than I did when I was younger.
Yeah, you're doing good work.
Yeah, thank you for doing that. I mean, it's what you're doing is important.
It is very important.
Thank you. Well, we'll keep all doing it. And if anyone wants to find our stuff, it's on unravelingadoption.com is the best place to go. Everything's there. We do have Patreon if you want to support us. You guys have Patreon too, right?
Yes. Thank God for Patreon.
We do.
Yeah. Patreon is great. It's an easy way for people to donate just a couple of bucks a month and you forget about it.
It helps us. We wouldn't be here.
Yeah. It just pays for those, all the software and all the things. And it's very helpful. So find both of us on Patreon. And I do have a coaching business. If anyone is looking for coaching, especially adoptive parents, I love to help adoptive parents to come out of the fog or, find resources, especially if their kids might be dealing with addiction or mental health or suicidality. I've been around the block on that a few times. So my heart is to help people like that. So send them on over. Well, thanks again, Louise and Sarah. This has been really great.
Thanks, Beth. Thank you.
Great.
And Louise, Sarah, and I want you all to stay
safe.